Our lecture for today is the abdominal organs. This is our study outline. At the end of this lecture, we should be able to describe the different compartments in the abdomen, the organs that are located within each of the compartments, the organ-organ relation, and how they are placed, and also some clinical conditions. The entire abdominal organs are divided into two, depending on where they are located. We have the digestive organ, which is located in the anterior compartment of the abdomen. We also have the renal organs, which forms organs of the urinary system, and these are located in the posterior compartments. Let's take the compartment one after the other. If you make an anterior incision in the anterior abdominal wall, the first compartment that we see is the anterior compartment. And within this compartment is where we have the organs that make up the digestive system. The digestive system basically is the collection of organs that perform the function of digestion. They are basically involved in the breakdown of food substances, the absorption of the wanted part of the food, and also the elimination of the unwanted part of the food that is being ingested. This is to say that digestion is not complete until after the unwanted part of the food are eliminated. This is a basic fact for digestion. So let's take the organs one after the other. Within the anterior compartment where we have the digestive organ, we can further divide these organs into the main digestive organ and also the accessory digestive organ. The main digestive organ includes the esophagus, the stomach, and the intestine. We also have other components of the main digestive organ, which include the oral cavity, the pharynx, and the anus. These are not located within the abdominal compartment, so we would not be talking about them. We would be limiting our discussion to only organs that are found within the abdominal compartments. Also, the accessory digestive organ are organs basically that are located along by the side of the digestive tract. They are not located within the tract, but you see them by the side. Their function basically is attributed to digestive function, but they are accessory because they are supportive, and this includes the liver, the gallbladder, and the pancreas. There are also some other accessory digestive organs like the teeth, the tongue, and the salivary gland. These are not located within the abdominal space. So our discussion will be limited to only organs that are located within the abdominal space. So go with me through this lecture as we take these organs one after the other. We describe them in a bit and also see how they are related to one another within the abdominal space. Let's take a look at the esophagus first. The esophagus is also called the food pipe. It is a tubular extension from the pharynx. It extends to become the stomach. So we can say it's an organ that is located between the pharynx up and the stomach down. It is about 25 cm in length. This esophagus runs from the cervical region, the neck, down to the thorax, then to the abdomen. And this creates a form of interest because there is actually a part that is called the diaphragm that separates the thoracic cavity from the abdominal cavity. So we can imagine how then the esophagus is able to cross through to enter into the abdomen. So there is actually a hole created on the diaphragm for the esophagus to pass through. And this hole is called the esophageal hiatus. The esophageal hiatus allows the passage of the esophagus from the thorax down to enter into the abdomen. We also have other hiatus within the diaphragm that allow other structures to also pass through. But the one we'll be concentrating on that is related to our lecture today is the esophageal hiatus, which is created on the diaphragm so that it will allow it to go down to enter into the abdomen to continue as the stomach. But because of the part that the esophagus presents, it is divided into three major regions. The cervical region is in the neck region, the thoracic in the thoracic cavity where it runs across it. Then as soon as it enters into the esophageal hiatus, there is a short course that it runs before it becomes the stomach, and that is called the abdominal part of the esophagus. This is to tell us that the esophagus basically is not an entire abdominal organ, but just the abdominal region of the esophagus forms part of the abdominal organ. So we should take note of that. If you look at the structure of the esophagus, we see that it is tubular in nature, and also food substances tend to enter into it from above and below the exit out of it to enter into the stomach. And this is why we have a sphincter. Sphincter basically at band of muscle that are formed to control the entry of food and also the exit of food out of the esophagus. So we have the upper esophageal sphincter, which is found around the entrance of the esophagus hub. Then we have the lower esophageal sphincter, which is formed around the exit of the esophagus. Between the two, we can categorically say that the lower esophageal sphincter is located within the abdomen. So the upper esophageal sphincter is out of our discussion because it is not located within the abdomen. So when you talk of the regions of the esophagus, we know that it's the abdominal region of the esophagus and also the lower esophageal sphincter that are located in the abdomen. Then we have the stomach. The stomach is an expanded portion of the GI tract. I have seen that the GI tract basically is seen to be presented with tubular configuration, but it gets to the distal part of the esophagus that there is an expansion. And this expansion takes a J-shaped format. And that is why they describe the stomach as a J-shaped organ. You can see the expansion down here. So we can say that the stomach is an entire abdominal organ because the entire region of the stomach is located within the abdomen just after the distal end of the esophagus. Looking closer at the internal wall of the stomach, we see the presentation of the mucosa being thrown into folds, and this is called the rugae. The internal wall are not smooth. You see elevation and depression, which create a form of folds. So the mucosa lining are thrown into folds, but this has a physiological importance. As food gradually enter the stomach, these folds begin to thin out so as to create space for expansion. So the rugae basically are to allow for the expansion of the stomach because they gradually disappear, and this complements for a concurrent increase in their size. The functions of the stomach. What does the stomach present in terms of function? For storage, it's like a storage tank. It also helps to digest protein, and this is done by the secretion of pepsin and renin that are produced by the sheath cell, convert protein to peptone, and that is breaking down protein into smaller units, while the renin tends to coagulate milk. It also mixes food because it is made up of smooth muscle wall. So as the muscle contract and relax, they are also in a way helping to mix the food. They also perform the function of sterilizing the internal environment of the stomach, and this is done by the hydrochloric acid contents. This tends to destroy unwanted substances or foreign bodies that find their way into the stomach. Sphincters. As we have sphincters in the esophagus, so also we have in the stomach. We've said sphincters are basically thick band of muscle, the cardiac sphincter. This also translates to the lower esophageal sphincter. And at the exit point, we have the phylloric sphincter, which controls the rate at which food exits the stomach. The omentum, if you look at the configuration of the stomach, we see that the stomach is expanded, is bulged, is big. And these structures, of course, need to be supported. So in creating a means through which this expansion will be connected to other organs within the digestive system is what gave birth to the formation of the omentum. The omentum, basically, we have two types. We have the lesser omentum, and we have the greater omentum. From the name lesser, it means it's quite smaller than greater, and also is related to the lesser curvature of the stomach. This means that this omentum connects the lesser curvature of the stomach and also the upper part of the duodenum to the liver. So there is a connection in the upper part through the lesser omentum. And the greater omentum, from the name is greater, it means it's definitely bigger than the lesser omentum. And also, it is related to the greater curvature of the stomach. This means that it connects the greater curvature of the stomach. From there, it rolls down. Then it decides to now turn against itself. Then rolling backwards again. Then get attached to the transverse colon. So at the end, the layers of the greater omentum will be four, while that of the lesser omentum will be two, because it's already a double-layered structure. So this connects lesser curvature to the liver. Why this connect the greater curvature? It connects and it goes down, but it gets to a point, it now turns over itself and goes backward up again to be connected onto the transverse colon. So this eventually making it a four-layered structure. So the omentum basically are to create structural support for the stomach, as we see that it is expanded part. So for it to be supported and also guided, and it is the omentum that have come to play the role of trying to attach it to other organs within the GI tract. The functions of this omentum, apart from giving structural support, they also help to create accommodation sites for neurovascular structures. Like in the lesser omentum, we have blood vessels that is going to supply the liver, are embedded within the double-layered structure. So it tends to create sites through which blood vessels run through to supply other organs. Also helps to prevent adhesion along peritoneal surfaces so that organs are not sliding on top of each other, are well placed within the space that they occupy. Fat deposition. We can see that the intestine basically usually have deposits of fat, but this would have been more if not for the omentum. So more of the fat are deposited on the surface of the omentum. So they tend to receive some fat deposits that are supposed to be embedded onto the small intestine. So you see them with a lot of fat deposition. Also, the omentum presents immune function. It also helps to limit the spread of intraperitoneal infection. And how it does this basically is by wrapping around the organs that are infected. So if it sees a situation that a particular region of the GI tract is infected, it tends to wrap around it so as to limit the spread of that infection to other organs. Let's look at a bit of chemical correlates of the stomach and the esophagus. We have the gastroesophageal reflux disease. Reflux means backflow. This means that there is a fault within the cardiac sphincter, which means that the gastric contents are able to flow back into the esophagus, and this can tend to lead to a form of irritation. You could also have esophagitis. Esophagitis basically is an inflammation of the esophagus, and this could be caused by irritation. It could lead to stenosis, which is narrowing the esophageal canal. You could have esophageal cancer, which is basically the growth of abnormal cell in the esophagus. Or you have esophageal diverticular. This is a congenital abnormality where you have an outpouch created in the esophagus. Food that are supposed to go down this lane are now being redirected to enter into this outpouch. And when they stay here for some time, they get decay and they can get infected. or you have gastric ulcer. This is very common. This is when you have sore that developed in the internal lining of the stomach. This is caused by a bacteria that is called Helicobacter pylori. It could also be caused by gluconic acid, smoking, or alcohol. Basic symptoms are burning abdominal pain, and treatment is with the use of antibiotics. The small intestine, this is the region that follows stomach, and they can be broadly divided into three parts. We have the duodenum, which begins from the end of the stomach down to the point of the jejunum, and the jejunum, which is the middle part. Then you have the ileum, which is the terminal part that drains into the cecum, which forms part of the large intestine. Basically, these three regions do not have a special line of demarcation. What we use to distinguish them basically is their caliber. So the first region is the duodenum, after which we have the jejunum, then the last part is the ileum. The large intestine extends from the cecum down to the anus. The large intestine is the second largest in terms of caliber in all the organs of the GI tract. So the question is, which has the largest caliber? We should know that this is the stomach. So after the stomach, the next one is the large intestine. So the large intestine forms a kind of foldings, and this folding is caused as a result of the lining of the tinea coli. The tinea coli are like bands of longitudinal muscle fibers, and you see them running along the entire length of the large intestine. But what causes this obstruction basically is that the length of the tinea coli that is running along the entire length of the large intestine is shorter than the length of the large intestine itself. This means that you have a particular length, then you have another structure that is going to be lining through the surface of that length, but the length of that structure is smaller and it needs to run through the entire length of that structure. So this will lead to a form of foldings in order to accommodate the length of what is lying on it. I hope this is understandable. So you have the tinea coli that is shorter, but must run through the entire length of the large intestine. That is why you have these foldings, so as to accommodate the entire length. And that is why you have the obstruction in the large intestine. Also on the side of the tinea coli, we have what we call fat deposits that are called epiploic appendages. You have it on both sides of the tinea coli. The subdivisions of the large intestine have the cecum. The cecum is like a pouch, which is the initial segment of the large intestine. This pouch is seen with a finger-like extension that is called the appendix. No major function has been attributed to appendix, especially as it relates to digestion. Sometimes food may get lodged in and tends to decay and inflamed, and this is what leads to appendicitis. So it does not have major function that is related to where it is located, which is digestion. So the initial segment is the cecum. We have the second segment, which is called the ascending colon, and you can see it going up, it's ascending up. When it gets to this right-angled region, it tends to flex and turn to the left. And the area where it flexes is called the right colic flexure. This can also be termed the hepatic flexure. So it runs in the transverse plane, and this region is called the transverse colon. When it gets to this other right-angled region, it flexes downwards again. And this is called the descending colon. So the point where it flexes here is called the left colic flexure or the splenic flexure. So it descends down as a descending colon. When it gets to this angle, it now runs an S-shaped configuration, and this is called the sigmoid colon. From the sigmoid colon, we have the rectum, then we have the anal canal, then the external environment. The function of the large intestine. The first half of the large intestine is for absorption and also recycling of food back into the bloodstream, while the second half is to compact waste and also secrete mucus that allows for lubrication so that the physics are easily passed out. Mesentery. Mesentery are double layer of peritoneum that attaches this the intestine to the posterior abdominal wall. The mesentery basically attaches this intestine to the posterior abdominal wall. The organ mesentery relation basically are in two formats. We could have an intraperitoneal organ, or we could have a retroperitoneal organ. Intraperitoneal organ basically means that the entire organ is invaginated by the peritoneum, so that the entire circumference of the organ is lined by the peritoneum. It means that they are intra, they are inside the peritoneum. So these are called intraperitoneal organ. Or you have a retroperitoneal organ, which means that the peritoneum basically touches one side of the organ. You can see this is the organ and the peritoneum just running through just one surface, and not as an intraperitoneal organ where it encloses the entire circumference of the organ. So where you see this kind of configuration basically is in the kidney, which will be in our subsequent discussion. The function of the mesentery is also to allow for the accommodation of blood vessels. Also, they enhance a form of organ movements, and also means that the degree of movement that is shown by this organ depend on the length of the mesentery, so that organs that have long mesentery are able to move a wider range of movement. The accessory digestive organ, the one we'll be looking at, is the liver, the gallbladder, and also the pancreas. So let's look at the liver. The liver is the largest internal organ, while the largest organ of the body we know is the skin, is on the outside, but within is the liver. The functions include detoxification, protein synthesis, and also the production of bile, which is used for the emulsification of fats. Liver can be divided into four lobes. These four lobes are unequal in size and also in shape. Also, when you look at it in the anterior view, you see two lobes, which are the right and the left lobe. You need to extract the liver and turn it the other way around to see the posterior configuration, where you see four lobes, which is the right lobe, the left lobe, the caudate lobe, and the quadrate lobe. So the entire four lobe can be seen in the posterior view. Why just two can be seen in the anterior view? You can see how interesting the liver is. The gallbladder basically is a small pear-shaped sac that is located below the liver. Why is it located close to the liver? Basically, it's because what the liver secretes, which is bile, is stored in the gallbladder. So this is like a storage tank for what the liver produces. So it needs to be closer to it. So what the gallbladder does basically is that it creates an active storage site for bile, which we have said. And another function that it exhibits is that it helps to concentrate the bile. So as the bile is stored in the gallbladder, it helps to absorb its water content, thereby making it to be more concentrated. We know that the more the concentration, the higher the rate of reaction. Also, talk about the pancreas, which is an elongated tapered organ that is located behind the stomach. The pancreas basically has two functions. It has an endocrine function and it has an exocrine function. The endocrine function basically is where it secretes insulin and glucagon, which are used for sugar reabsorption in blood. And the exocrine function basically is where it secretes pancreatic juice and it remits it into the lumen of the duodenum, so that undigested carbohydrates, protein, and lipids are digested. The entire food substances coming from the upper part of the stomach may not be completely digested. So the remaining one that are left undigested are taken up by the pancreatic juice that is secreted by the pancreas to further break them down. The posterior abdominal space. So when we remove the GI tract organ in the anterior space, so this is the background we see at the back. What we see at the back basically is the renal organ, which are kidney and the ureter. We know that the urinary system is made up of the kidney, the ureter, the urinary bladder, and the urethra. But the urinary bladder and the urethra are located below. So what we see within the abdominal space is the kidney and the ureter. So we will be taking them one after the other. The kidney is ring-shaped organ. It's about the size of a human fist. Its dimension is 12 in length, 6 in breadth, and in thickness is 4 cm. It is erythroperitoneal. Remember, we talked about the relationship of organ and mesentery. We talked about intra and retro. So the kidney is a very good example of erythroperitoneal organ. Posterior part of the kidney is not lined by peritoneum. The peritoneum only touches the anterior surface of the kidney, which means that it helps to hold it to the posterior abdominal wall, as if you are trying to hang a calendar on the wall, the root and the hilum. Let's talk about the hilum first. The hilum is like an indentation that you have on the medial surface. This indentation is not created for fun. This is created because structures will be going into and out of this region. So this indentation is termed the hilum. While the structures that actually go into and out of the kidney through the hilum is called the root. So this entire structure, which are basically the renal artery, the renal vein, and also the ureter, form the root of the kidney. An allowance that is created for the root is called the hilum. Renal artery supplies deoxygenated blood to the kidney, while the renal vein takes deoxygenated blood out of the kidney. The ureter also collects urine out of the kidney. So structures are actually going in and also coming out. So the entire structures that are going in and coming out is termed the root, while the indentation that is created on the medial wall of the kidney is called the hilum. And this creates allowance for the structures that forms the root. The kidney has two surfaces. It has an anterior surface and a posterior surface. We've talked about peritoneal relationship. We should know by now that the anterior surface is the only surface that is lined with peritoneum, while the posterior surface is devoid of peritoneum. It also has two borders. It has a medial border, which is the part that is directed towards the midline plane, while it also has a lateral border, which is the border that is directed towards the lateral wall of the abdomen. And also, we should know by now that in the medial border is where we have the hilum and also the root. It has two poles. It has a superior pole, upper pole, and an inferior lower pole. The difference is between the superior and the inferior pole is that the superior pole is bigger, is thicker, is more rounder, while this is smaller, is thinner, and also less rounder. This roundness and bigness is to create sites where the adrenal gland will lie upon. So this bigness basically is in tune of creating a space for the adrenal gland. The adrenal gland basically also called the suprarenal gland, which is supra means above, renal means kidney. So it's a gland that is located above the kidney. The chief responsibility of the adrenal gland is to release stress hormone, which is called adrenaline and norepinephrine. And this hormone basically prepares the body for emergencies. The minor function that they exhibit is through the secretion of aldosterone, which is involved in salt water balance. So this is just a minor function, but their major function is for emergency preparation. The ureter. The ureter is a narrow tube that extends from the renal part of the kidney. It's made up of smooth muscle, so it carries urine that already formed in the kidney down to the renal bladder where it will be stored. Look at our previous lecture on the ureter. You see that we divided the regions of the ureter into two, the abdominal region and also the pelvic region. The abdominal region ranges from the renal pelvis down to the pelvic brain, and from the pelvic brain down to the mouth of the urinary bladder where it will be studied, the pelvic part of the ureter. So it is only the abdominal region of the ureter that is located within the abdomen. Some clinical anatomy of the kidney. Diabetes mellitus, which is characterized by high blood sugar, and also diabetes insipidus, which is basically the inability of the kidney to concentrate urine. Could also have renal failure, and this is when the microscopic unit, which are the nephron, fails to perform their function, their inability to extract unwanted substances from blood and also to filter them or reabsorb the wanted part back into the bloodstreams. This will lead to kidney failure. And basic treatment options are hemodialysis, which is basically removing those unwanted substances directly from blood, or renal transplant, as the case may be, which involves the replacement of the failed kidney. Or you could have a urinary tract infection, which is caused by bacteria. Thank you for watching. Let's continue to upgrade our knowledge in anatomy through this channel. Thank you.